Bismillah, alhamdulillah, wa salatu wa salamu ala rasulillah wa ala alihi wa sahbihi wa sallam, amma ba'd. Alhamdulillah, we are here now for this event, this exciting event here with our brothers from DAARUSSUNNAH, Dawah. And alhamdulillah, we have with us today our Shaykh Hasan Somali and our brother Shamsi, also known as brother Shamsi. Barakallahu feekum. And today's topic, inshallah, will be steadfastness in turbulent times, in these turbulent times. And inshallah, this topic will encompass quite a lot of different points. But we want to just focus on a few that are affecting the Muslimin. Of course, as we all know, fitna affects Muslims in all walks of life, in every part, every aspect of their life. And it's important to have the proper guidance when it comes to these things. So without further ado, because we're running a bit late, we're going to go straight to our Shaykh Hasan Somali, Hafidhahullah, and he's going to give us a short intro before we jump into the questions. Barakallahu feekum. Assalamu alaikum wa rahmatullahi wa barakatuh, Shaykh Hasan.
Wa alaikum assalam wa rahmatullahi wa barakatuh.
Hayakum, hayakum Allah.
Hayakum, kif halukum.
Tayyib, so when you're ready, tafaddal.
Alhamdulillahi rabbil alameen, hamdan kathiran, tayyiban, mubarakan fee, kama yuhib rabbuna wa yirda. أشهد أن لا إله إلا الله وحده لا شريك له وأشهد أن محمدا عبده ورسوله أما بعد. So with regards to some of the ways or means to remain firm in these turbulent times, and these times are challenging from many different aspects and angles, but alhamdulillah, we find in the Quran and the Sunnah various ways through which the servant can implement to try and stay firm and balanced in such chaotic times. And I know we're running a bit late, and Maghrib here, I think it's around 30 minutes time. I just want to mention briefly, if we look in the Quran, Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, he tells us about how to remain firm in this life and also how to successfully be firm in the grave when we are asked the questions of the grave. If we look at some of these ayat, Allah Azza wa Jalla subhanahu wa ta'ala, he said, أَلَمْ تَرَى كَيْفَ ضَرَبَ اللَّهُ مَثَلًا كَلِمَّةً طَيِّبَةً كَشَجَرَةٍ طَيِّبَةً أَصْلُهَا ثَابِتٌ وَفَرْعُهَا فِي السَّمَاءِ. Have you not seen the example that Allah Azza wa Jalla put forth? He gave the example of a good word, like a good tree. The roots are firm in the ground, and the branches, they stretch out, meaning to the sky. If we look at this example, alhamdulillah, it shows us the importance of what? The importance of tawheed, the correct belief. That, brothers and sisters, is the foundation in order for the servant to remain firm. If you look back to the scholars of tafsir when they explain this verse, when Allah Azza wa Jalla says, subhanahu wa ta'ala, لَمْ تَرَى كَيْفَ ضَرَبَ اللَّهُ مَثَلًا كَلِمَةً طَيِّبَةً كَشَجَرَةٍ طَيِّبَةً. Have you not seen the example that Allah put forth? The like of a good word is like a good tree. A good word, the statement, La ilaha illallah. None has the right to be worshipped in truth except Allah alone without any partners. It's like a good tree. And subhanAllah, Al-Imam Al-Baghawi rahimahullah, if you go back to his tafsir, he mentions that some of the reasons why the good word, which is Al-Iman here, referring to faith, referring to the kalim of ikhlas, La ilaha illallah, it is compared to what? A healthy, good tree. Limada, why? Because in order for a tree to be healthy, it has to have firm roots, a solid base, and the branches have to stretch out and be lofty, stretch out towards the sky. The same applies to faith. In order for Iman, faith, to be sound, it has to be what? Deeply rooted in the heart, present in the heart. Likewise, it has to be pronounced upon the tongue, and at the same time, it has to manifest upon the limbs. And Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, he tells us, حَفِظَكُمْ اللَّهُ, with regards to the benefit of this firmness. Because that is the reason why we were created. We were created to worship Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala alone, without any partners. وَمَا خَلَقْتُ الْجِنَّ وَالْإِنسَ إِلَّا لِيَعْبُدُونَ. I did not create the jinn and mankind except to worship me alone. That is why we were created. Our allegiance revolves around this. This is the key to prosperity in this world, and it's the key to paradise in the hereafter. And Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, he tells us, تُؤْتِي أُكُلَهَا كل حين بإذن ربها. This type of tree, meaning this type of believer, firm belief in the heart, meaning they study about at-tawheed. They study about the correct Islamic belief. It's firm in the heart. They pronounce it upon the tongue and they manifest it upon their limbs. It will give its fruits at all times. The like of this tree and the like of this believer, this type of mu'min, they will give their fruits at all times, on all occasions. وَيَضْرِبُ اللَّهُ الْأَمْثَالَ لِلنَّاسِ لَعَلَّهُمْ يَتَذَكَّرُونَ. And Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala puts forth these examples for mankind so they may reflect and remember. So in these turbulent times, my advice to myself and the brothers and the sisters, let us learn about Tawheed, learn about the correct Islamic belief, implement it in our lives, make sure that we understand it correctly, teach it to those who are around us, and alhamdulillah, we will see the fruits, bi'idhnillahi ta'ala, in the short term and in the long term. And then in the next verse, Allah Azza wa Jal subhanahu wa ta'ala, he tells us that, حَفِذَكُمُ اللَّهِ وَمَثَلُ كَلِمَةٍ خَبِيثَ كَشَجَرَةٍ خَبِيثَ. The like of an evil word is like an evil tree. And some of the mufassirun, they say this is referring to shirk. And shirk is the total opposite to what? Tawheed. And Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala tells us that this type of tree will be uprooted from the earth. There's no stability. A storm comes, it's going to blow the tree over. There's no qarar. There's no stability for this type of tree. And that is the mushrik. There's no stability. They will be all over the place. Today, they will believe this. Tomorrow, they will believe something else. Today, this is moral. Tomorrow it will be immoral. And so on and so forth. And then Allah Azza wa Jalla, and I'll close with this, alhamdulillah, so we can continue. But again, a lot can be said about the importance of Tawheed and the importance of the Sunnah of the Prophet Sallallahu Alaihi Wasallam, the danger of shirk and the danger of bid'ah. Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala tells us from the fruits of at-tawheed in this world, from the fruits of implementing at-tawheed, from understanding it correctly, Allah says, يُثَبِّتُ اللَّهُ الَّذِينَ آمَنُوا بِالْقَوْلِ الثَّابِتِ فِي الْحَيَاةِ الدُّنْيَا وَفِي الْآخِرَةِ وَيُضِلُّ اللَّهُ الظَّالِمِينَ وَيَفْعَلُ اللَّهُ مَا يَشَاءُ. That Allah will make firm with a statement of firmness, La ilaha illallah, which is the statement, none has the right to be worshipped in truth except Allah, those who believe in this world, and he will make them firm in the akhirah. And we find the explanation of this is that Allah will grant the believer firmness when they are being questioned in their grave, and Allah misguides the zalimeen, the oppressors, and we know that the greatest oppression is shirk. And Allah Azza wa Jalla does as he chooses. So to sum it up, yes, alhamdulillah, we find various things in the Quran and the Sunnah that are mashru'a, that are legislated to assist us to be firm in these chaotic times, where you see individuals, wal-iyadu billah, uttering things that you would never imagine would come from the mouth of a Muslim. You have individuals who are graduates of Islamic universities who are meant to be specialists in certain sciences, casting doubt, wal-iyadu billah, on the book of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, to the extent that even some of the non-Muslims, the evangelicals, and the Islamophobes are delighted by the likes of these statements from these individuals. Why? Because these individuals, they're not firm. They were not granted success to have this firmness of belief. Because if somebody had firm belief in their heart, they would never utter and manifest these type of statements. So I advise myself and the brothers and the sisters, alhamdulillah, to study about Kalimat al-Ikhlas, the statement La ilaha illallah, understand its conditions, understand its meaning. Likewise, understand the reality of shirk, the dangers of shirk, na'am, and how to stay away from it. Because alhamdulillah, if a person was to take this approach and start with that, you would see that alhamdulillah, by the will of Allah, you would see that that individual will be firm and be able to weather many of the storms and a lot of the confusion that may arise in this time and even in times to come. Wa jazakumullah khairan.
أحسن الله إليكم وبارك فيكم يا شيخ حسن ما شاء الله الحمد لله. Yeah, that was clear. So of course we have with us also on the connection our brother Shamsi. السلام عليكم ورحمة الله وبركاته Shamsi.
وعليكم السلام ورحمة الله وبركاته حياكم الله.
حياكم الله. Listen, so now that our Sheikh has given us a short intro, is there anything you'd like to add?
بسم الله الرحمن الرحيم الحمد لله والصلاة والسلام على رسول الله وعلى آله وصحبه ومن والاه وسلم تسليما كثيرا أما بعد firstly it's my pleasure to be sharing the same platform with the Sheikh Hasan Somali our beloved brother may Allah preserve him and may Allah bless him likewise our brother Abu Zaynab حفظكم الله جميعا to be honest there's something which I want to add of course, as our Sheikh Hasan mentioned, there's, you know, you can make lectures concerning the issue of being firm at the time of trials and tribulations. And there's not any doubt the cure is in the Quran and the Sunnah, as our Sheikh Hasan al-Somali have stated. And he mentioned something about the, in our time, you hear shubuhat coming from people who have been graduated from, you know, Islamic universities. And subhanAllah, we're in a time when you don't expect shubuhat. Now the shubuhat is coming from every angle, and guess shabab. Now the adat Islam, the Islam haters are focusing more on shabab. So it's upon us to learn our deen and to study and to know that after Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, in order for us to be saved from the fitan and the mihan, is to go back to the book of Allah and the sunnah of Nabi alayhi salatu wassalam. Especially as I was discussing with the Sheikh Hasan al-Somali, in our time, ilhad, atheism, is spreading amongst the shabab worldwide. So we should also focus on that, refuting the doubt and the lies and the misconception against Islam. But also we should focus on correcting our aqidah first. We don't want to be like the other people, mainly focusing on refuting the Islam haters, but they have nothing to offer to the shabab. So we have to, as the scholar said, at-tasfiyah wa tarbiyah, purification and cultivation. So we purify ourselves from shirk, we purify ourselves from innovations, we purify ourselves from sins, and we cultivate ourselves and our families and our friends and our neighbors upon the Tawheed and the Sunnah and upon the Ta'at al-Rahman, the obedience to Allah Tabaraka wa Ta'ala. And we have to make dua always, Allahumma ya muqallib al-qulub, thabbit qulubana ala deenik. As I was speaking, you know already, Abu Zaynab, may Allah preserve you, like Sheikh Hasan, majority of the time I'm giving dawah outside, mixing with the Shabab. So the stuff that you hear from the young brothers and sisters, you know, we have to make dua for them and for ourselves as well, because no one is safe from the trials and tribulations and khasas in our time. And we know our Prophet Muhammad والسلام, told us about the fitan that will occur at the end of time. So as our Sheikh Hasan mentioned, the cure to go back to the Quran and the Sunnah. And Nabi والسلام, he said, يُسْبِحُ الْمَرْءُ مُسْلِمًا وَيُمْسِي كَافِرًا أَعُوذُ بِاللَّهِ مِنْ ذَلِكَ. Now we can see it. A person will go sleep as a believer and wake up as a disbeliever, selling his deen from lowly things from this dunya, exchanging his deen. May Allah save us all. So Allah musta'an, barakallahu fikum. And you know, I have to humble myself with my Sheikh Hasan al-Somali and forgive me for, you know, adding, you know, barakallahu fikum
jami'an. With regards as well, jazakumullah khair. You know, Shamsi mentioned something that is important. With regards to the youth, and this is also applicable to the adults, because the adults are not immune. Anyone who's still living is not immune from doubts. And prevention is easier than cure. And alhamdulillah, as the brother he mentioned, when Allah Azza wa Jalla said in the Quran, وَقُلْ جَاءَ الْحَقُّ وَزَهَقَ الْبَاطِلِ إِنَّ الْبَاطِلَ كَانَ زَهُقًا, say that the truth has come. The truth, the Quran and the Sunnah is the truth. It has come. And it, falsehood has departed and it's fleed. And falsehood will always flee in, you know, when it's faced with the truth. And the truth is, قال الله, Allah said, قال رسول الله صلى الله عليه وسلم, that the Messenger of Allah صلى الله عليه وسلم said, with the understanding of the companions. And I just wanted to give one example, or a few examples, if we can give a few examples. I know that time is short. Let's give a few examples. If you look, حفظكم الله, Ali ibn Abi Talib, رضي الله عنه, the first from the adults to accept al-Islam was Abu Bakr, the first from the women was Khadija, and the first from the children was Ali radiallahu anh. He was approximately 10 years of age when he accepted the religion of al-Islam. Ali radiallahu anh, he was nurtured upon what? He was nurtured by the Prophet sallallahu alayhi wa sallam upon the Quran and the Sunnah. And we all know that Ali radiallahu anh, he went on to become one of the rightly guided khulafa. And the Prophet sallallahu alayhi wa sallam, he said, as comes in the hadith, لو أعطينا الراية, I will give the standard to an individual, رجل يحب الله ورسوله ويحبه الله ورسوله, to a man that loves Allah and his messenger, and Allah and his messenger loves him. Ali radiallahu anhu, he was nurtured upon what? Quran and Sunnah. He learned his religion. And look at the legacy that he left behind. Likewise, if you were to look at the likes of Abdullah ibn Abbas radiallahu anhuma, when the Prophet sallallahu alayhi wa sallam, he said, Allahumma faqihu fi ddeen wa allimhu ta'weel. Oh Allah, give him understanding of what? Understanding of the religion. Give him understanding of the religion. And give him understanding of the Quran. And alhamdulillah, Abdullah ibn Abbas, to the extent that when he was a young man, Umar ibn al-Khattab radiallahu anhu used to include him in the sittings of consultation because of his precision and understanding and comprehension of the book of Allah Azza wa Jal. And you can go on, Abdullah ibn Umar radiallahu anhuma and many others. Abdullah ibn Umar, he narrated the most ahadith from the Prophet sallallahu alayhi wa sallam after Abu Huraira radiallahu anhum ajma'in. May Allah be pleased with all of them. But these individuals, and this is what we hope. We hope that the youth, we hope that they're going to be better than us, inshallah ta'ala. We hope that they will be able to defend the religion more than we are able to defend it. But in order for them to be individuals who are prepared, you know, to face what is taking place in this time, they have to be firmly rooted in knowledge of Quran and in Sunnah with the understanding of the Salaf of this Ummah. To the extent, Imam Ahmed rahimahullah, Imam Ahmed, he said at his time, look, and this is the time of Imam Ahmed, he said, La a'lam al-yawm. He said, I do not know a time where the people are ahwaj, are more in need of talab al-hadith, the knowledge of hadith, than the time that we're living in now. That was the time of Imam Ahmed rahimahullah ta'ala. And it was said, Qila lima, he was asked, why is that? Why is it that the people need the knowledge of hadith now more than ever before? He said, Zaharat bid'ah. Innovations have appeared and become manifest. And he said, whoever does not have knowledge of hadith with them will fall into innovation and misguidance. If that was the time of Imam Ahmed rahimahullah ta'ala, what about our time? So I encourage myself and I encourage the youth. And like the youth, the reality is they're going to be facing the challenges and the battles of tomorrow. It's the youth. I encourage myself and I encourage the youth. Prepare yourself. Learn the book of Allah. Learn the sunnah of the Prophet sallallahu alayhi wa sallam. Learn what you can of the Arabic language. Learn what you can of mustalah al-hadith, the science of hadith. Learn the sciences of al-Islam, alhamdulillah, according to the way of Ahlul Sunnah, so that you can be prepared because it's going to be your responsibility. May Allah Azza wa Jalla grant you all success.
Barakallahu feekum. Excellent examples there, Shaykh Hasan. You know, I know the time running out, so I want to jump straight into the questions. Barakallahu feekum. But you know, we need more of this. We need more of this. Excuse me for saying this type of interaction. The people are in need of it. Alhamdulillah. We need the brothers to get more involved, more intimately involved in some of the affairs. Because, you know, there's so much fitan. There's so much things that are, you know, affecting the Muslim ummah today and the army, the regular layman Muslim. That, you know, like even right here in our country in Trinidad and Tobago, there's, you know, so much things happening. Islam is so alienated, so, you know, estranged that, you know, of course, everywhere. And you guys, you know, we have, of course, Shamsi from London. We have, you know, our Sheikh Hassan there in Philly. So, you know, alhamdulillah, this type of cooperation, we need it. And to show that the Muslim Ummah that, you know, alhamdulillah, we have a consolidated, united front. You know, alhamdulillah. So without some of the questions, I mean, mashallah, we was overwhelmed with questions. Alhamdulillah. And I mean, there definitely would not be time for us to address not even half, but at least if we could take, you know, yani just one or two small questions that could try to help us, guide us on the path here. So the first question, and I will ask Sheikh Hasan to address. Recently, we've seen the actions of those ignorant, rebellious Muslims who have committed that heinous atrocity in France in response to the school professor's use of the Charlie Hebdo's cartoon of the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam. Now, the French president, he has responded, and even the Turkish president has responded. And in this current heightened atmosphere of Islamophobia that's in France, and of course, by extension, all around the world, how can we as Muslims defend the honor of the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam and be balanced and just with regards to the, you know, the localities that we live in and so on and so forth? Barakallahu fikum.
The first thing that has to be established, alhamdulillah, these individuals, those who, you know, defame and try and ridicule the Prophet Muhammad sallallahu alaihi wasallam, they can't harm the Prophet in the slightest, as Allah Azza wa Jalla, he tells us in the book of Allah Azza wa Jalla, inna kafaynaka al-mustahzi'in, that we have protected you from those who ridicule you and those who insult you. So they can never harm the prophets of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. Secondly, we condemn any violence against any civilians, whether it's beheadings or anything else. So that has to be clear. However, the approach that we see some people taking under the camouflage, and in reality, it's a deceitful tactic of freedom of speech, because it's not freedom of speech to ridicule and mock someone that has nothing to do with what is taking place in France or anywhere else. The Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam, Prophet Muhammad, is innocent of those barbaric actions of a tiny minority of people in France who do not represent Islam, nor do they represent the Prophet Muhammad sallallahu alaihi wasallam, nor do they represent the Muslims. But this incident also, it shows us something else, that those who claim to be the voice of reason and justice and fairness in the world, then this is not the case. Rather, we see the irrationality, we see the lack of logic, and we see this xenophobic and fascist approach to such important and dangerous issues. And the reason I say that is because if you wanted to unite the people of France or any other country in the world to marginalize these rabid fanatics, these terrorist extremists, who, due to their perverted worldview and twisted ideology and theology, believe that it's okay to murder innocent people, then you would target them specifically and you wouldn't further widen the issue to people that are totally innocent and have nothing to do with these fanatics. But if we were to analyze and dissect why, this is politics. This is politics. Why is it politics? Because in some European countries, it's nothing to do with Prophet Muhammad sallallahu alaihi wasallam. The characters that they are drawing, they look nothing like the Prophet Muhammad sallallahu alaihi wasallam. I don't know what they represent, but they definitely don't represent any of the descriptions that we find in the authentic Sunnah for Prophet Muhammad, peace and blessings be upon him. But what has happened in some European countries, we've seen a rise over the years in xenophobic and likewise fascist ideas. And this is politics. So the far right has become more vocal and more popular among some of the citizens of these countries. So politicians who normally would claim that they are moderate, you see them trying to satisfy the right. And the easiest way is to marginalize further and oppress minority people who are already discriminated against because of their religion, because they're Muslims. They're already discriminated against in education, employment, and other areas of life. So demonize them because they're an easy target. And this is not something new. In the reality, Europe should be embarrassed, because anyone who studies history, this is the same approach, wal-iyadu billah, that Hitler had, the way that he treated the Jews. And it's a very dangerous approach. People ask, why are we seeing, you know, a rise of the far right in America or in the UK or in various countries in Europe? And I believe, and this is my opinion, when you allow Islamophobia and you've allowed in the media Muslims to be targeted since 9/11, and for Muslims, the majority, 99.9% of Muslims, are peace-wanting individuals. And they want the same. They want to live in peace, and they want the protection for themselves and their families, and they want to live in harmony with everyone else. They just want to practice their religion. But since 9/11, irresponsible segments of the media have demonized Muslims and made them the scapegoats and focused upon, you know, Muslim communities. And even some politicians, when it's time for elections, you see statements being made comparing women to that wear the niqab to a letterbox. Or when there's, for example, it's the election is approaching, now, for example, a politician where the niqab has nothing to do with the discussion, rather it should be to do with his policies, he makes a scapegoat of the Muslim minority who are already being attacked on a daily basis. And the statistics are there to back everything that I'm saying with regards to the amount of coverage that was directed to demonize Muslim communities after 9/11. So we have to understand the reason for these type of things. Now, going back to the original question, how should we respond? As Muslims, we should respond the way that Allah Azza wa Jal has legislated for us to respond. And that is what? That is to follow the sunnah of the Prophet Sallallahu Alaihi Wasallam. That when they try and defame the Prophet, that we adhere to his sunnah even more. That we adhere to his teachings even more. That we speak about his virtues even more. That we defend him even more. That is what we should do. We should not go out in the street and behave recklessly, because that is what the Islamophobes want. They want to say, didn't I tell you, look at these insane and extreme Muslims. That's the carrot that they place before the horse. Our response should be, in light of these things, and, you know, one of the leaders said Islam is in crisis all around the world. Actually, I don't know what world, you know, they're looking at, because I see various problems all over the place, and the crisis is not with Islam. It's actually with the system that they boast about on a regular basis. But from us as Muslims, it is upon us to adhere to the teachings of Muhammad sallallahu alaihi wasallam, Prophet Muhammad sallallahu alaihi wasallam, even more. As Allah says in the Quran, قُلْ إِن كُنْتُمْ تُحِبُّونَ اللَّهَ فَاتَّبِعُونِي يُحْبِبْكُمُ اللَّهُ وَيَغْفِرَ لَكُمْ ذُنُوبَكُمْ. Say, if you truly love Allah, then follow me. So when they're insulting the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam or attempting to, let us show them, alhamdulillah, the way that we respect the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam. And let us try and imitate him in his sunnah. And we know his sunnah is his statements, his actions, his approvals, and his sifa. So that is a brief response with regards to how we should respond. Don't respond the way that they want us to respond. Let us be wise and respond with wisdom and knowledge. Shamsi may have something to add. Shakarallahu lakum.
Ahsan Allahu ilaykum. Excellent. Allahu Akbar. Allahu Akbar. Excellent points. And just my two cents before we bring it over to Shamsi. You know, one of the things I think is important that I often tell people here in Trinidad and Tobago is, you know, our Gheerah, our jealousy for Muhammad sallallahu alaihi wasallam, it doesn't just stop with Muhammad sallallahu alaihi wasallam. It's with all the Anbiya. So, you know, I'm just as disgusted and I'm just as, you know, appalled when we see they making fun of Jesus alayhi salam, or if there's, you know, caricatures or cartoons or so on making fun of Isa alayhi salam or Musa alayhi salam, Moses and Jesus. It's not like, you know, obviously Muhammad sallallahu alayhi salam, the most beloved of creation, the best of creation, but at the same time, every one of the NBA, so this freedom of speech that they have and this whole idea of, you know, oh, we should be able to mock anybody we want, and we don't tolerate it for Muhammad sallallahu alaihi wasallam. We don't want to tolerate it for any other of the NBA, any of the other
even Yusuf, like you said, but it's not tolerated for everyone, because in European countries, if you speak about certain communities and you say certain things, it could lead, you know, in prosecution. No. And it can lead in a criminal case, which is justified, you know. Racism, fascism, it should not be tolerated. But it just shows the hypocrisy and the double standards. They hide behind freedom of speech.
Yeah.
You know, Hitler most probably would have hid behind it, you know, during his time.
Naam. Sahih wallah. Naam, brother Shamsi. Let's hear your take on it. Barakallah feek.
Barakallah feekum. Jazakallah khair, Shaykh Hasan. What I will mention, what the Shaykh, one of the scholars mentioned, that one of the ways to react is by exposing them, by refuting them, not by going and killing innocent people or مظاهرات protesting. For example, one of the ways to expose them recently, I'm not sure if everyone is aware of it, the president of Turkey, Erdogan, wafaqahullah, spoke out against and refuted the French president, and he called him psychopath. So the French president, he called out his ambassador in Turkey to come back to France because he's not happy how Erdogan spoke against him. But well, hold a second. If you are portraying and you are the supporters and the defenders of freedom of speech, so why are you so angry against Erdogan because he just said a few words against you? That's showed what the contradictions of these people. And also, there's an Algerian girl that she said about the journalist who drew the picture, not Prophet Muhammad's picture, but who drew the picture. She said he should be put in prison. So they said, no, because it's freedom of speech and you are going against freedom of speech. So we should take you to the court for that because you won't stop us expressing and practicing our freedom of speech. But she's practicing and expressing her freedom of speech. So we know here, clearly these people, they don't follow what they preach. Because on one hand, they say we are here for freedom of speech. We are here to let people be free. As they say in Francais, la liberté. You know, freedom, you know. But in France, again, they force Muslim sisters to take off their hijab in order for them to go and study. On the other hand, they accuse us of oppressing women by not allowing them to study. But you are oppressing women too, because those women clearly, explicitly are saying to you, in France, we are happy with our headscarves. No one forced us to wear hijab. We are proud of it. So why don't want us to study? Why don't want us to educate ourselves just because we are wearing a garment which we believe our religion? So like one of our scholars, alhamdulillah, wrote an article refuting them, exposing them. And that is one of the strongest and the best way to expose their hypocrisy, to expose their double standard. As the Shaykh Hasan mentioned, where I guess violence, like, you know, going and killing this person, because you are in a non-Muslim country, so you have to follow the law. Okay, you have to follow the law. So what is the way, as our Shaykh Hasan mentioned, to follow the Sunnah of Nabi alayhi salatu wasalam? Likewise, to show them that you're proud to be from the Ummah of Muhammad sallallahu alayhi wasalam, that we love this person so much that we imitate him alayhi salatu wasalam. So grow your beard, wear qamis, imitate the Nabi alayhi salatu wasalam, that will hurt them more. The other way to show the hypocrisy. Show the hypocrisy. Barakallahu feekum.
Wafikum barakallah. Ahsant. Good points you made there. And Allahu Akbar, you know, the easy thing. Again, we just, as you know, today we had our Q&A with Sheikh Abdullah, Dr. Abdullah Zafiri, Hafidhahullah, and he mentioned these same points. You know, and one of the things, as you mentioned, and you keep reiterating, Sheikh Hasan and Brother Shamsi, following the sunnah. At the end of the day, they call the Prophet Sallallahu Alaihi Wasallam kahin, they call the Prophet Sallallahu Alaihi Wasallam soothsayer, they called him, you know, storyteller, poet, etc., etc., and none of that affected him. None of that affected him. So I know sometimes it's difficult for us to ignore these attacks on the Prophet Sallallahu Alaihi Wasallam, but sometimes it's what...
Can I add something, akhi?
Nah,
if you don't mind.
Fadal.
Afwan, and afwan for Shaykh Hasan. Remember the story of when there was a woman, she was calling Nabi alayhi sallam mudammam. And Nabi alayhi sallam, what he said, look how Allah protected my name from their mouths. Because she was, and the rest of the other pagans were mocking him. When they were mocking, he said, alayhi sallam, the person they are mocking is mudammam, but my name is Muhammad. Allahu Akbar. Look how Prophet Muhammad sallam dealt with it. So the cartoon they drew is not Nabi alayhi salatu wasalam. Of course, we get angry. Of course, but we get angry and we control our anger according to Islamic legislation. Prophet sallam, of course, he was not happy. Likewise, the companions. But look how he dealt with the situation. He said, the person that are mocking is Mudammam. But my name is Muhammad. Allahu Akbar.
Even if you look in Bukhari, you know, and Bukhari brings it in the chapter, the alamat of al-nubuwa fil Islam, the signs of the prophethood of Muhammad sallallahu alayhi wasallam. He brings the narration of an individual that used to be a Christian and he returned back to Christianity. And he started to say that لا يدري محمد إلا ما كتبت له. Muhammad only knows what I wrote for him. He apostated. And this individual, when he died, they buried him, his companions buried him, and the earth kept spitting him up. That was his uquba, his punishment. So this individual insulted the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam, and look at the torment in this world, and even the torment of the barzakh, the grave, and even in the akhirah and the hereafter. So Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, he promised that he's going to protect Muhammad sallallahu alaihi wasallam. Inna shaniyaka huwa al-abtar. The one who insults you, you know, he will be severed, he will be cut off. Wa rafa'na laka dhikrak. Allah said, and we've raised you in mention. I'll stop the adhan. You hear, hafidhukum Allah. It's time for salah here. I'll let them finish the adhan, inshallah, and then we can continue afterwards.
Tayyib, let me ask you just while how much time do you think we have left? Because we have quite a lot to cover.
Like about 15 minutes, inshallah.
Tayyib, inshallah.
So yes, I mean, the shahid, you know, this individual, look how, subhanAllah, he was punished. He never got away with insulting the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam. But at the same time, you know, the sahaba, the companions, ridwanullahi alayhim, when the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam was insulted, when the believers were in Mecca, they didn't behave like those lunatics, you know, in France who were running around beheading, you know, civilians. And responding like this, it plays into the hands of, you know, those, the Islamophobes who want to demonize Islam. And also depicting Prophet Muhammad sallallahu alaihi wasallam in such a fashion, it also plays into the hands of the extremists. So you have extremes on both sides of the fence. You know, you have the extremists who are drawing pictures of what they claim is Prophet Muhammad, and it's not Prophet Muhammad sallallahu alaihi wasallam. And then you have the extremists who have perverted ideology and have a twisted understanding of Islam.
Barakallahu feekum. Okay, well, while we're on that train of thought, basically, the next question I want to just skip to is, as we know, coming up this week here, we're going to have the purported birthday of the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam, the Mawlid or Mawlud. Right. And I think it's appropriate for us to probably address that because, you know, many Muslims around the world will celebrate it with the intention that, you know, they're doing it out of the love of the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam, and, you know, they want to rever on the best of creation. A lot of innocent Muslims, in the sense that they don't really have, you know, the proper knowledge, and they just think to themselves, okay, well, look, the Christians celebrate the birthday of their Prophet Isa, Christmas, for example. And, you know, we want to celebrate the birthday because we love him so much. So what should be our balanced approach in dealing with, you know, this celebration and those who celebrate it? You know what I mean?
I mean, with regards to the Mawlid, the celebration of the birthday of the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam, I think the issue is very simple. I don't think it's complicated at all. Allah Azza wa Jalla said in the Quran, Al-yawma akmaltu lakum deenakum wa atmamtu alaykum ni'mati wa raditu lakum al-islam ad-deena. This day I perfected for you your religion. The religion of Islam, alhamdulillah, is complete. It is perfect. And the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam, he said in the hadith of Aisha, man ahdatha fi amrina hadha ma laysa minhu fa rad. Whoever innovates into this religion of ours, that which is not from it, then it is rejected. A simple question to anyone who supports celebrating the birthday of the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam. Did the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam celebrate his birthday the way that these people encourage the Muslims to celebrate his birthday? The answer is no. Did he encourage with this? The answer is no. Then we look at the companions. Let us start with Abu Bakr and Umar and Uthman and Ali radiallahu anhum ajma'in, the rightly guided khulafa. Did any of them encourage us to celebrate the birthday of the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam the way that the people are celebrating it today? The answer is no. Did they celebrate the birthday of the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam? No. Likewise, did any of the companions, none of the companions encourage with celebrating the birthday of the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam, nor did they celebrate it. And I do not think that you will have an aqil, a sensible person from amongst the Muslims, that will claim that they love the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam more than the companions. So the companions of the Messenger of Allah sallallahu alaihi wasallam, they love the Prophet more than anyone else. Yet they did not celebrate his birthday. The students of the companions, the tabi'un, none of them celebrated his birthday, nor did they encourage anyone else to celebrate it. Nor did their students, atba' al-tabi'een, nor did any of the imams of the religion, none of the imams of the former dhahib, Imam Malik, Imam Shafi'i, Imam Ahmad, al-Imam Abu Hanifa, or any of the imam al-Islam celebrated the birthday of the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam. Where did this practice come from? It came from a heretical sect who innovated it into the religion of al-Islam. So I think the answer is clear. Alhamdulillah, This is one of the issues where you can truly differentiate between those who adhere to the Sunnah of the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam and those who give lip service. Because Ahlul Sunnah, they reject all innovations, regardless of who comes with them. It's not enough just to come and now start naming a list of scholars who, from a few hundred years ago, that celebrated the birthday of the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam or supported it. And you list a bunch of scholars after the Salaf, after the Al-Qurun Al-Mufaddala, the three praiseworthy generations, and you claim that this is in support of celebrating the birthday of the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam. Rather, the statements of the scholars, which is known, the statements of the scholars are not a proof in themselves. Rather, they require proof. Allah said in the Quran, فَإِن تَنَزَعْتُمْ فِي شَيْءٍ, if you differ in anything, then do what? Return it back to Allah and His Messenger. So it's simple. If we want to demonstrate our love of the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam, and look, this is one day. One day that, subhanAllah, even some people, لا يصلون الصلوات المكتوبات, they may not even pray their daily prayers, but they find it easy to come out and, party and sing and so on and so forth. هل ينفعهم هذا? Would that benefit them the slightest? الذي لا يصلي ولا يصوم. The one who doesn't pray, the one who doesn't fast, but he comes out one day and he claims that he's manifesting his love of the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam. That is just symbolic on one day. And it's an innovation, and all innovations are misguidance, and all misguidance is in the hellfire. Rather, if you want to demonstrate your love of the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam, then follow his sunnah. We mentioned the verse in the Quran, قُلْ إِن كُنْتُمْ تُحِبُّونَ اللَّهَ فَاتَّبِعُونِي يُحْبِبْكُمُ اللَّهُ وَيَغْفِرَ لَكُمْ ذُنُوبَكُمْ. Say, O Muhammad, if you truly love Allah, then follow me. Follow the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam. لَقَدْ كَانَ لَكُمْ فِي رَسُولِ اللَّهِ أُسْوَةٌ حَسَنَةٌ. In the Messenger of Allah, you have the best example. So someone who loves the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam, they would follow him. And they follow him on a daily basis. Alhamdulillah, they believe how he believes. They pray how he prayed. Naam, they try and have their character in accordance to his character sallallahu alaihi wasallam. They adhere to his sunnah with regards to appearance and so on and so forth. That is how we demonstrate our love of the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam. Just coming out and singing Sufi type songs is symbolic and it's worthless in reality, on top of the fact that it's an innovation, and even that type of innovation, it has led people, wal-iyadu billah, to even errors which are even graver than the motive itself. And you find some people, wal-iyadu billah, claiming all types of things, like, for example, the Prophet attends gatherings and he forgives people for their sins and so on, and that he has knowledge of the unseen, shirkiyat, wal-iyadu billah, and other, grave errors. Barakallahu feekum.
Jazakumullahu khairan. Yeah, I think as you mentioned, Hassan, the matter is a simple matter. It wasn't done by the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam. It wasn't done by anybody else. But I know, like the little bit of time I spent in England at one time in the UK, they'd be doing some crazy stuff in England, man. Like I see man coming out in processions, with green and white, the Barelavis and all these different Sufis and sects. And so, and it's amazing because I think this week I was showing you, Hassan, there's a group in the US there. They've come to the point where they sent out a poster. They want people to pledge salawat. And they reach a point where they say they want to pledge a billion salawat. So the goal is to pledge a billion salawat on the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam. I mean, subhanallah, a'udhu billah. It's like, I believe it was Ibn Mas'ud, correct me if I'm wrong, who said that all bid'ah starts as something small and then it gets bigger, right? Subhanallah, look at where they reach. A billion salawat, what kind of foolishness is this? I mean, look at the level to where they take this thing. And the sunnah is so simple, so sweet, so normal, so something so easy to practice. So, you know what I mean? Allah al-Musta'an is something that, it amazes the aql, the intellect.
I mean, it's funny because even, for example, from in Butte Town, maybe longer, Allahu a'lam, maybe 100 years ago, they used to have processions where they used to go in the street and they used to walk around, celebrating the birthday of the Prophet, Maulid al-Nabi. And the people, this was what people, the non-Muslims, they thought, this was an Islamic practice. But alhamdulillah, Allah Azza wa Jal, and I say that to highlight the blessing of the da'wah of Ahl al-Sunnah, the people of the Sunnah who have clarified that this is not from Islam, and it's not an Islamic celebration. Alhamdulillah, the Muslims, we have Eid al-Fitr and we have Eid al-Adha. These are the Islamic festivities, not, going in the street and celebrating the birthday of the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam. And that's why, again, in these turbulent times, the people of the Sunnah, they cannot allow themselves to be intimidated where they're silenced. Yes, okay, you have the Sufis. It started with that Sufi pact that, you know, Yasir Qadhi and them signed, I think more than 10 years ago, more than a decade ago. But that pact, again, it was deceitful. There was no reality behind it. We were all meant to be silent about one another. That was the agreement. I mean, them. But were they silent about Ahlul Sunnah? Were they silent about the Salafis? You know, to the extent that even they give lectures in front in non-Muslim universities where they demonize, you know, those who ascribe to Salafiyah in front of the non-Muslims. Forget about the Muslim community. This was all, again, it was an agenda. And it was in the interest of Sufi and the Sufis, because Sufiyah was disappearing to a certain degree in the West. So let us come up with something to silence our critics. Let us utilize some individuals from Islamic universities in the world that will give us a sense of credibility. And we will utilize these people to try and silence the masses. Alhamdulillah, it did not work. Walillah alhamd wal minna. Even though the reality of certain individuals became clearer. But alhamdulillah, the people of Sunnah, it shows the importance, brothers and sisters, of continuing to try and learn about Tawheed and propagate it, to learn about the Sunnah and to propagate it, to warn against shirk and to warn against bid'ah, and to do all of this upon knowledge. And not to stop and to continue, alhamdulillah, because we see the amazing fruits of the da'wah of the people of the Sunnah, like I said, all over the world. To the extent that even in the place, like I said, in Bhutan, where we are from, alhamdulillah, they don't even do this. I don't think so. Wallahu a'lam, hasbi ilmi, I haven't seen it. I don't think they have the like of these processions, even though there are Sufis still there, but it's not, you know, they are not as brazen as they were before. And that is from the blessings of the da'wah of Ahlul Sunnah, the people of the Sunnah. And may Allah just strengthen the da'wah of the people of the Sunnah wherever they are. And may Allah support them and give them strength.
Barakallahu feek. Listen, so the time running out. So I want to give, Shamsi, I'm going to give you an opportunity to weigh in on the last question, because I think we're down to the last question now. But I believe it's very important before we leave this meeting, and we'll definitely have to reschedule our next one, because obviously we had a little technical difficulties. But this is the, you know, we're talking about turbulent times, right? We're talking about fitna. Definitely the biggest fitna that a lot of us are facing today, obviously Muslim, non-Muslim, is the whole COVID-19 pandemic. Right, and the atmosphere that we live in. So yesterday, for example, in Trinidad and Tobago, the Prime Minister opened up the country. It's been the, you know.
Before to cut you, can I add something to the last one?
Toddle.
Yeah, I just want to add something, which, you know, one of their doubts about the Mawlid, because, you know, their doubt is the Hadith, which is Sahih Muslim. When a man came to the Messenger of Allah, sallallahu alayhi wa sallam, he said, "Ya Rasulullah, ma ra'yuka fi siyam yawm al-ithnayn?" Or kama qal. He said, "What do you think about fasting on Monday?" And Nabi alayhi salallahu alayhi wa sallam said, "That day I was born, and on that day I received revelation." So some of them tried to derive from this hadith that it's permissible to celebrate Prophet's birthday, alayhi salallahu alayhi wa sallam. But again, when you go back, and Nabi alayhi salallahu alayhi wa sallam never understood, or Sahaba, they never understood from this hadith to celebrate Prophet's birthday on the 12th of Rabi' al-Awwal. That's why one of the Muslim scholars said, when he was debating with one of these guys who supports celebrating the Prophet's birthday, he said to him, quote unquote, "If you want to do Prophet's birthday the correct way, then fast every Monday." Nabi alayhi salallahu alayhi wa sallam told the person to fast every Monday, because that day he was born, also that day he received the revelation. So out of gratefulness to Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, or coming together, dancing, singing, you know, cakes and so on. As our Shaykh Hasan mentioned, this goes back to Al-Ubaydiyun, who invented this in the 4th century, deviated sect, Qaramita, Al-Ubaydiyun. Al-Ubaydiyun, their founder, was a person that came from Iraq, and he traveled to North Africa, and he claimed that his lineage goes back to Prophet Muhammad alayhi salatu wasalam. However, the Muslim scholars, as Ibn Kathir have mentioned in Bidaya wa Nihaya, the Muslim scholars all agreed that that is not the case. Ibn Dhabi likewise mentioned that this person, his name is Ubaidullah al-Mahdi Billah. This person, his lineage doesn't go back to Nabi alayhi salatu wasalam. So at the time of Al-Hakim bi Amrillah, one of his offspring that ruled Egypt and Sham, or just Egypt and North Africa, Tunisia, he started celebrating his birthday and Prophet Muhammad's birthday and the birthday of Al-Hussein or Fatima, if I do remember exactly. So clearly this culture, or this celebrating Prophet's birthday doesn't go back to Nabi alayhi salam, doesn't go back to Sahaba, doesn't go back to Imam Abu Hanifa or Shafi'i. It goes back to a deviated sect and one of the leader, which is the worst one, Al-Hakim bi Amrillah, who claimed that he was God. So again, that we love Nabi Isa alayhi salam. We love him. How we love him? As our Shaykh Hasan mentioned, the verse in the Quran, Surah Ali Imran, قُلْ إِن كُنْتُمْ تُحِبُّونَ اللَّهِ فَاتَّبِعُونِي. If you truly love Allah, follow me. Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala did not say, if you truly love Allah, celebrate his birthday, Prophet's birthday. No, follow him. And what is the outcome? What is the fruit of following our beloved, the best man that walks on the face of the earth, Muhammad bin Abdullah alayhi salatu wasalam? The outcome of following him, Allah said, قُلْ إِن كُنْتُمْ تُحِبُّونَ اللَّهِ فَاتَّبِعُونِي يُحْبِبْكُمْ اللَّهِ وَيَغْفِرْ لَكُمْ ذُنُوبَكُمْ. Allah will forgive you and Allah will love you and forgive your sins. Allahu Akbar. Barakallahu feekum.
Even the thing about it as well, Yusuf, just generally, you know, one thing, الشبهات كثيرة, you know, doubts will always be many. You know, لا نهاية لها. They're never going to stop. No. There's always going to be doubts. Yeah, you know, الشيطان هو الذي أسسها. The shaitan is the one that formulates these doubts and he will continue to formulate them. However, as I mentioned earlier, the statement of Imam Ahmed rahimahullah ta'ala, when he said, I do not know a time more than today when the people are in need of learning hadith, meaning learning the sunnah of the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam. And learning the sunnah because it's easy. You say to them, where's the ayah in the Quran? Where's the hadith of the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam? Where's the implementation of the Sahaba? Khalas, the discussion is over. No. Anyone can bring a doubt to anyone. And like the Shamsi mentioned, Jazallah khairan, they bring the hadith, like in fi kulli dalil ya'tuna bihi, huwa yani hujja alayhim fil haqiqa. Every proof that they bring is a proof against them, if you look in reality. The hadith that they bring, alhamdulillah, it shows implementation of the sunnah of the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam to fast upon that day. Not to get together and, you know, in gatherings of ikhtilat and to sing and to dance and, you know, behave erratically. You know, that's not from the sunnah of the Prophet sallallahu alayhi wa sallam. But alhamdulillah, I have to leave you guys, but ansahuk inshallah, tastamirun inshallah, continue. We have to pray here.
Do you, I'm want sure to, any question. You want us to give you like 10 minutes and we could continue?
No, because I have, after this, I have my lesson in
Dawah. Well, let's close off with that then, because, I mean, we could always reschedule another time.
It's but I'm saying, alhamdulillah, there's a lot of questions. And Shamsi is there, jazakumullah khairan.
Okay, I mean, we could take another 10 minutes, Shamsi, if you're down for that.
Yeah, I'm saying, because there's
mushrab. No problem, tayyib,
now, one of the things I want to say in your presence before you go, alhamdulillah, Shamsi, you know, the good thing about it is what I like about your man like Shamsi, hafidhakallah, you know, you bring to the table, alhamdulillah, historian, man, mashallah, you know, you bring us the, you know, and that's the good, that's the balance we have. We have this, you know, I mean, a nice, sweet and savory kind of thing going on, because alhamdulillah, we have, you know, Sheikh Hassan giving us points, and then, you know, alhamdulillah, Shamsi bringing in the historical aspect. That's really good. I mean, again, it's something we all need to hear. We need to hear from the people of knowledge, those who have experience, those who have been involved in the da'wah, and alhamdulillah, it's good. So I know it's not going to be the last encounter we have, inshallah.
Sheikh Hassan, talab. يا أخي قلهم يأخرون آخر الدرس معك
لا الإمام موجود سبحان الله
لا بعد الصلاة أخرها
والإخوة مجتمعون ما تراهم لكن ينتظرون
سلم عليهم ينتظرون عليهم
يعني ينظرون إلينا سبحان الله
give salam to the جماعة فأس حسن
طيب
السلام عليكم الحمد لله we have here with us again our brother Shamsi and we want to just round up with a few maybe one more question here because there's quite a lot, as I said, inshallah, Shamsi, we're going to reschedule another one because we're off to a late start here today. And obviously, Allahu Akbar, there was a lot of questions. And I just want to mention something to the viewers, those who've been sending in questions. Alhamdulillah, we have several link ups with the Mashaykh over the week, you know, on a weekly basis. Sheikh Abdullah, Sheikh Dr. Abdullah Dhafiri, Sulfiq Dhafiri, Habidahullah, we have Sheikh Abu Ammar Ali Hudayfi, Al-Adani, Habidahullah, Sheikh Ali Wasifi, Habidahullah, from Egypt and different regions, right? And of course, we have our Mashaykh from the Duat in the UK and in the US, Sheikh Abu Hakim, Sheikh Abu Khadija and others. We're going to try our best to answer as many of the questions as we can over the next coming weeks, whether it be via the podcast or, you know, in one of the sessions. So try and tune in as much as you can to hear the questions answered. Follow us on the Twitter, DAARUSSUNNAH, Dawah, MPubs, and so on. But of course, one of the things I want to mention quickly before we continue, when you're asking questions, just as an etiquette, number one, we are not a replacement for a fatwa line. So a lot of times people send questions, personal questions about, you know, their personal situations in their lives, things like that. We can't address those things. Those things should be taken to the kibar al-ulama, or they should be taken to, you know, your local Salafi imam, so on and so forth. You know, and things like that. We can't entertain those type of questions. Also, narratives. Sometimes people send booklets. You know what I mean? You have to summarize the question as much as you can, you know, and stick to the topic as much as possible, because people send booklets, akhi. You know what I mean? Questions with like dockets, and you have to go through 7 pages to get to the point of the question. I know sometimes, you know, everybody wants to give details and they want their questions answered. Alhamdulillah, we're here to facilitate that, to connect the people to the ulama, connect the people to the mashayikh. But alhamdulillah, there's only so much we could do, you know, and we have to try to maximize the efforts. So, barakallah feek. Let's jump into the very next question. And one of the ones that I want to select here, and of course, again, it's dealing with some of the different turbulence that the youth may face, or as Hasan said, not just youth, but the adults. Many young Muslims, the questioner says, many young Muslims get caught up in celebrating or taking part in like Halloween, New Year's Day, Christmas, Mother's Day. What advice to these young Muslims, especially those who don't know the history or the origins of the festival? So mashallah, our historian, mashallah, Shamsi, I have to say I respect that about you, man. Alhamdulillah, you always, you know, you're well read and you do your research when it comes to the history. Alhamdulillah. So what advice could you offer in terms of these celebrations, people getting caught up, family, having family gatherings, you know, how they could deal with it, how they could give da'wah to them, how they could, you know what I mean, cope with this type of situation? Barakallahu
fiqh. The best thing to do with it is sometimes, in order for you to make your family understand the severity of the situation, you have to show them the roots of these events. For example, Christmas. For example, what is the origin of Christmas? What is the Christmas? One of the historians mentioned that on the 25th December, people that worship the sun, they used to believe on that day they will get the power from the sun. When the Roman pagans accepted Christianity, brought that with them. And there's other historians from the Sumerian historians mentioned that it goes back to Namrud. Namrud, he got married to his own mother and he died on the 25th of December, and she used to go visit his grave every 25th of December, believing that his soul comes back to visit her at the grave. And she used to bring what they call it, a gift to him. So again, look to the asl of it, to the roots of these festivals. However, as we say, I was telling my daughter Aisha, may Allah bless her, because she was asking me, what is the, why we're not allowed to do that? So I was saying that the reason now they are deceiving many people, because they are beautifying it with, you know, let's get happy, it's for children, to buy gifts. What is the problem with buying gifts? What is the problem with exchanging gifts? There's no problem with that. We as the Muslims, we have been ordered all the time to exchange gifts, to take care of our families, our friends, our neighbors. But there's people out there who wants to push their agenda, their paganism, but they want to hide behind, for example, when it comes to Christmas, behind Christianity, Jesus. We love Jesus, but Christmas has nothing to do with Jesus. Even there's many Christians who tell you that. Likewise, Halloween. Halloween is a day when the people glorify the devils, you know, glorify the demons. But the high, they said, no, it's just fun. Yeah, but we don't have to disobey the Most High. We don't have to disobey the Creator and obey the Satan to have fun. We can have fun without doing these evil things. So the advice that we have to stay away from it, and we should not participate in paganism festivals, and we should teach our families, our friends, our neighbors in a good manner, in a good way, with a respectful way, with the nice words, showing them based upon the clear proofs, based upon history, that this event or this celebrations goes back to the pagan, to the pagans. Doesn't go back to Moses or Abraham or Noah or Jacob or Jesus. I hope that is a claim. Allah bless you all.
Jazakallah khair. I mean, yeah, you're right. You know, a lot of, not just the Muslims, a lot of the Christians or even, you know, non-religious people, I should say, they are aware of the fact that a lot of these things have pagan origins. And that is a shubha that they bring. They say, okay, well, you know, yeah, it's pagan, you know, okay, yeah, no problem. But, you know, it's for the children, you know, it's for the kids, it's for the this, it's for the, you know, and that,
yes, that is something yes, that's
that,
what I'm saying.
Again, is something that, as you say, the Muslims, alhamdulillah, the Prophet ﷺ encouraged us to give gifts regularly. It increases the love between one another. Look, me, myself, randomly, sometimes we would just do a, you know, a gift giving for our family, you know, things like that, just to make them feel, because of course we live in the West, so we have to, you know, we have to obviously give our kids some sort of alternative. We can't let them feel, you know, that, okay, yes, the Christians are the ones that are having all the fun and we're not having all, you know what I mean? So alhamdulillah, we are allowed to have entertainment as long as it's halal, as long as it's, you know, within the bounds of the Sharia. Mm-hmm. And alhamdulillah, it's a cleaner, nicer lifestyle. So we don't have to disobey the Creator, as you put it, barakallah fiq. We don't have to disobey our Creator and it's and in order to enjoy ourselves. So, all right, let's just take one more question before we wrap up here. Naam. So the question I asked, barakallah fiq, we hear today so much talk about, you know, Salafiyya and the Salafis, and alhamdulillah, it's, you know, it's become widespread that I think a lot of people know that Salafiyya is the haq, you know, and there's so many different people calling themselves Salafi and Allahu Alam where they stand in certain positions. But one of the shubuhat or one shubha that we hear often is, you know, the Salafis always refute people all the time and all they do is refute and they never cooperate with other groups when it comes to, you know, refuting the right things, which is, for example, atheism or the plots of the kuffar. You know, why don't the Salafis get together and cooperate with these people? What, you know what I mean? So, you know, can you define for us what is Salafiyya and some of the attributes that can help us recognize the true adherents of Salafiyya? Barakallahu fiqh.
Nah, barakallahu fiqh, akhi. To me, myself, many people contact me via our Instagram, Facebook, even in Speaker's Corner in the park, even at Dawah table. People asking, akhi, some of them saying, you know, I never knew about Salafiyya. But after you explain what is Salafiyya, Salafiyya is Islam. Salafiyya is the deen of Allah tabaraka wa ta'ala. So I start learning, alhamdulillah. Some of them, they don't know, they want to learn about it. Firstly, what we have to establish, my brother, may Allah bless you. Likewise, may Allah bless the brothers and sisters who are watching, that Nabi alayhi salatu wa salam told us and have prophesied about splitting. He said, will come a time when the Muslim Ummah will split up into 73 sects. We have to understand that Salafiyya is not, the Salafis are not the one who caused splitting, meaning they want to cause split amongst the Muslims. No. The Salafis wants to unite the Muslims. However, they want to unite the Muslims upon the Quran and the Sunnah, upon the way of Abdul Mustafa alayhi salatu salam. Just earlier on, we were speaking about people mocking Nabi alayhi salatu salam, and we get angry, we protest. You don't have to protest. If you truly love Nabi alayhi salatu salam, then follow his teaching. No. Follow his teaching, no, alayhi salatu salam. So when Nabi alayhi salatu salam told us that the Ummah was split into 73 sects, the Ummah was one Ummah during his lifetime. They will call what? هُوَ الَّذِي سَمَّاكُمُ الْمُسْلِمِينَ مِنْ قَبْلُ وَفِي هَذَا. Allah mentioned, he's the one who called you the Muslims. So there was one group, Muslims, kuffar. That's it. After the death, not the time of Abu Bakr, no, after the death of Uthman bin Affan, radiallahu anhu, arda, that's when the Ummah starts splitting up. No. The first sect appeared, Al-Khawarij. So there's the main body. The main body, which is Nabi alayhi salatu salam and his companions. Now, at the time of Uthman bin Affan, one of the people left the main body, who are the Khawarij. Then, the reaction of the Shia. Then who? Al-Qadariya. The Qadariya came out at the time of Abdullah bin Umar. The time of the Sighar al-Sahaba. Then who? Al-Jahmiyyah. So there are people leaving the main body. Who are the main body? Al-Nabi alayhi salatu wasalam and his companions. Al-Jahmiyyah, the followers of Jabir ibn Safwan. Then Al-Mu'tazila, the followers of Was ibn Atta al-Ghazal. Then who are they after them? Al-Sha'ira, Al-Maturidiyya, or before the Al-Kullabiyya. So what we're doing now, instead of blaming the other sects for leaving the main body, for leaving the Prophet Muhammad sallallahu alayhi wasallam and his companions, we are blaming those who are still holding onto the main body. Those who are still holding onto the Nabi alayhi salam and his companions. And we are telling them, why are you splitting up? No, my brothers and sisters, they are not the one who split up. The other groups left the main body. So the other brothers and sisters who are still holding onto the main body, we should be happy with them. We should not rebuke them. So what is the? How do you differentiate who are the main body, who are following the true teaching of Nabi alayhi salam? Salam. Alhamdulillah, our Salaf, our pious predecessors, the Sahaba, their students, who Nabi alayhi salam praised them. He said, the best people in my generation and those who come after them, they start writing books to clarify who are the true followers of the Prophet Muhammad sallallahu alayhi wa sallam and his companions. They start writing usul, principles for you, my brother and my sister, may Allah bless you, and I, to differentiate between the deviated one and the people who are upon the truth. Because we have to establish and we have to believe that Prophet Muhammad alayhi salam does not speak from his own desires. He clarified the truth to us. Whatever brings us close to Allah, he told us about it. Whatever takes us away from Allah has warned us against it. And that which takes us away from Allah splitting and following desires and misguidance over following Nabi alayhi salam. And that which he left us upon clear guidance, which is the way of his and his companions. So from their characteristics, the first thing they're called to, a tawheed, the oneness of Allah, worshipping Allah alone, singling out Allah in worship, in his names and attributes, in his rububiyyah, in his lordship, in his worship, in his divinity, ubudiyyah. Likewise, they follow the companions and they don't speak ill of the companions. They defend the companions. Likewise, they do not promote people of innovation, people of misguidance. They do not cooperate with the people of misguidance, with people of innovations. Likewise, they are upon the clarity. They clarify the truth and they spread the sunnah and they call people to sunnah and they refute innovation and misguidance and they call tawheed and the sunnah in detail and they warn against shirk and misguidance in detail. That is what they, some of their characteristics, and I will highly recommend my brothers and sisters, may Allah bless you all, to go back to our lectures on the US Dawah channel, which I went through the risala, the essay of a Shaykh Al-Allama Salih Al-Fawzan, the principles of Al-Sunnah wal-Jama'ah. May Allah bless you all. So we stop here, inshallah ta'ala. We ask Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala to give us sincerity, and we ask Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala to unite the Muslims and open the Quran and the Sunnah. So we are the true callers to unite, to unity, alhamdulillah. However, we call to the unity which Allah called to in the Quran, which the Prophet Muhammad called to in the Sunnah, which the Salaf al-Salih, the Sahaba called to, likewise their students and their students. Not the unity of those who say, let's cooperate with the Rafida, let's cooperate with people misguidance for the greater benefit. No. Yes, and they try to use the doubt about some of the Muslim leaders, they were Asha'ira. Some of the Muslim leaders, they were Maturidis. Some of the Muslim leaders, they were such and such from the deviated groups, and the Muslims came under them. That is a clear-cut misunderstanding, because those leaders, they're still Muslims and we have to obey them and we should not rebel against them. However, the Muslims, Ahl-Sunnah wal-Jama'ah, that fought against the enemies of Islam under these leaders who were upon misguidance, they still clarify the truth and they still warn against their misguidance without mentioning their names, because following the Sunnah of the Nabi alayhi salatu wasalam. I hope that is clear.
Naam, barakallahu feekum. Hafidhakum Allah. Listen, one point before we go, and I just remembered as a good example before that I want to give you all, I want to give the viewers a local example here of something in Trinidad and Tobago. You know, on the point of the Salafis always refuting this one, refuting that one. You know, Imam Ahmed, there's a statement where he mentions, if I remain silent and you remain silent, who will clarify the truth? You know, there's a festival here in Trinidad, right, as a historical background, just a nice point for the viewers to take away that they perhaps would never hear from anyone else. There's a festival in Trinidad that is a public holiday. It's called Husay, H-O-S-A-Y. That festival, the origin of it were the Shia came to Trinidad in the days of the indentured laborers. They were East Indians from India that were brought here by the British to work on the sugarcane plantations. The East Indians brought Islam to Trinidad. right, which would have been modern day Pakistan and of course other parts of India. When they established, and of course there were also African slaves that brought Islam here too, but it's not a history lesson. But alhamdulillah, when they brought Islam, there were Shia here as well, a'udhu billah. And these Shia started practicing in a town here in Trinidad called St. James. They would practice up a festival in the same Ashura, right? Ashura, where they would, you know, beat themselves or whatever. Now, what ended up happening was, because no one spoke out against it, because it was never refuted, this festival evolved and it evolved and it evolved. Till today, you know what this festival is? It's a big street party. It's a big street party now, right? People come out in the streets. They'll parade a masjid that looks like a Husseini masjid from one of the Iraqi, Iranian things or whatever. And people will be on the street, you know, jumping up and whining and dancing and drinking alcohol. And it become a big festival. Kuffar involved themselves everywhere. So it's lost anything to do with Islam. Not that it had anything in the inception to do with Islam because it was Shia. But any semblance of Islam is gone. Again, if we don't speak up, and you don't speak up, and the Salafis don't say something, and the people of Sunnah don't say anything, what's going to happen? These things evolve, and they become worse and worse and worse, and Shaitan takes us down a dangerous path. It's the same thing. Look at what happened with the Maud. Look at what happened with all these things. So it's the job of the Salafis. It's the job of Ahl Sunnah wal Jama'ah. We see people committing shirk. We see people committing bid'ah out of love for them and guidance for them. We call them away from it and we warn them against it with proofs and evidence from call Allah, wa call Rasul, wa call a Salaf. So alhamdulillah, just a practical example for you to
mashallah, subhanallah, barakallah.
And that is a public holiday in Trinidad, eh? That is a public holiday in Trinidad. It's a big festival here now, subhanallah. So you know,
shukran akhi, barakallah fik, subhanakallah, bihamdik, shudu an la ilaha illa ant, astaghfiruka wa atubu ilayk, wa usalli wa usallim ala nabiyyina Muhammad wa ala alihi wa sahbihi ajma'in. وسلم سليما كثير
بارك الله فيكم خلاص we'll catch you in the next episode إن شاء الله
إن شاء الله حياكم الله السلام عليكم ورحمة الله وبركاته
السلام ورحمة الله وبركاته